Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to day 9 of prayer. Can I get you to stand to your feet this morning? Can you help us lift up the name of Jesus? Come on, put your hands together. We love to call your name. It's something we cannot explain that happens when we proclaim your great name. Your great name, yeah.
We love to call your name.
Say, we cannot explain.
We cannot explain that
when we proclaim. If you believe in the power of the name of Jesus, can you put your hands together this morning? Say, we love to call.
We love
call
to
your name.
Call your
it's
name.
Something
it's something
we cannot explain.
We cannot explain
that happens
when
we proclaim
your great
name.
Your
great
name.
Jesus.
No other name.
No
other
name. Nobody strong. We're so grateful this morning that there is power in the name of Jesus. Sing it if you know it. Power in your name. There's power in the name. There is power in the name of Jesus. Power in your name.
Come
on, lift your voice and say, there is power in the
name of
Jesus.
Power in your name.
Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm going to give you a second chance. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Come on, rejoice and be glad in it. We choose to rejoice. It's a Monday morning and it's 6 a.m. and you're here to worship the Lord and to pray. And I'm so proud of you. So glad you're here. Welcome to day number 9 of the 21 days of prayer. Give somebody a high five around you and just tell them you're glad to see them, and welcome all of you who are joining us online. So grateful that you've taken this time to be with us. We're going to pray together. We're going to experience the presence of God on Martin Luther King Day. We're going to talk about that today. Go ahead and grab a seat. We are led by some tremendous people in this church. In addition to the pastors and the staff that provide leadership to our dream team, we have a board of overseers that protect the church, and then we're strengthened by covering pastors. And one of our dear covering pastors is Dr. Joanne Lyon. Dr. Joanne Lyon and her husband, Pastor Wayne, who's over here in the front row, a great man of prayer, a great intercessor, a pastor. And they led a multi-ethnic congregation in the Washington, D.C. area. And during that time, many of the members of that church were from a small country called Sierra Leone. And it broke their pastors' hearts to hear what was happening in the nation of Sierra Leone and how this country was going through a horrific civil war. And something sparked inside of Dr. Joanne Lyon that I must go and make a difference. And she traveled over to that country. Long story short, the work that she did put that country on the radar of the current president of the United States, the prime minister of England, and World Hope was born. And World Hope now is in 35 different countries. And she is an incredible leader and eventually became the leader of the Wesleyan Church worldwide. 8,000 congregations, the first woman ever to hold that position. She is no joke. I won't tell you her age, but she is not slowing down. I will just tell you that. She's on fire for God. And she's going to bring you a word today, specifically about the day that we are living in right now. So put your hands together and welcome Dr. Joanne Lyon.
Well, I couldn't help but think when we were singing that song, the name of Jesus, quickly. I remember I was in the country of Cambodia, and one of the men there told me that the Khmer Rouge was there. Have you known about the killing fields and all that kind of thing? And he said, and they were after the intellectuals. He's a professor at the university. And he said, they came up with a gun at his head, and he said he'd heard who Jesus was. He was a Buddhist. He said, I think I've heard who Jesus is. And so he just called out, Jesus! The guy with the gun at his head pulled the trigger. Nothing happened. Pulled the trigger again. Nothing happened. Third time, nothing happened. He threw the soldier threw the gun away and left. And he's been a believer ever since, I want you to know. That's the power of the name of Jesus. So thank you all. That just touched me this morning. Well, today I just want to say to church, I don't know, but something is happening here. I've been in many of these, but this is different, Pastor Darren. There is a greater anointing of the Holy Spirit here in ways that we can't quite describe. And as I've studied revival throughout renewal movements throughout the world, it starts like this. It's partly like this. In fact, the renewal movement in the 1800s, the city of Rochester couldn't even go to work, the whole city, because they needed to go to the service that night. That's how the Holy Spirit moves. Now, I know we're going to work, so I'm not telling you to stay home. But the Holy Spirit is moving here. And you know what? We just follow it. We don't control it. We just follow it. So I've loved the scriptures that we've had regarding fasting, and the very first one that Darren put up for us when we told about what fasting was. And then today, we're going to look at another fast. This is we've had knowledge, wisdom, direction, all of the fasts. I love the way each of those have been described. But today, the fast is out of Isaiah 58, 6, and 7. And it is what I refer to as the fast of compassion and justice. Let's take a look at this verse. Is this not the kind of fasting I have chosen? to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Now you see, this was written in the 8th century BC. The culture was not a lot unlike our culture. There were very, very rich and very, very poor, and they oppressed them. There was also slavery in those days at that time. And here the prophet Isaiah is saying, this is the fast the Lord has called you, his people, to loose the chains of oppression. This was the very scripture when we were here in our own United States and we were working against the evil of slavery. It was this very scripture that led people. And it continues to lead us today. We have to do this. Now, one of the things that I find when we look at compassion is not pity. I feel sorry for you, and I'll throw a couple of bucks in the Salvation Army kettle. That's not compassion. Compassion is depriving yourself to give to others. Depriving yourself to give to others. Another statement is very interesting. It is, live more simply so that others may simply live. Live more simply so that others may simply live. And then when we look at this issue of oppression, we're talking about systems that keep people down. No way can they move out. It's referred to as systemic evil, systemic injustice. And so today, as we look at this day celebrating the birth of Martin Luther King, we've studied him, we've read him, but I would suggest today, someplace along the line, you read his letter from the Birmingham jail. It is powerful. It is interesting. He's in jail, not because he's done anything criminal. He's in jail because of what he's standing for, this very text. Not the kind of fasting. He is the fasting of chains of break the chains of injustice that are taking place in our country at this time. And so it's interesting, he writes this letter. Now, I find it interesting, just a little paragraph here, parentheses. Many of us find ourselves in jail in different times. I don't mean a physical jail, but we find ourselves in a jail that we didn't deserve. I just want to say, not everything that happens to you is God's will, but everything that happens to you, God can redeem it. It isn't always your fault, but God redeems it. So what do you do when you're in that little jail? We have the New Testament because Paul didn't break the law, but they didn't like what he had to say, so he was in jail. And he wrote, and we have the New Testament. Martin Luther King says, what else can one do when he is alone in a narrow jail cell other than write long letters, think long thoughts, and pray long prayers? And we have this today, and we have the New Testament, because that's literally what Paul did, and that's literally what Martin Luther King did. So as I read the letter from the Birmingham jail, there were so many things I wanted to bring to you today, but this one I wanted us to take a look at because I think it says this scripture of what we are to do and how God wants to help us. So I want you, I've got this on the slide, and this text from it. And you can Google the letter from the Birmingham jail and read it today. Whenever the early Christians entered a town, the people in power became disturbed and immediately sought to convict the Christians for being disturbers of the peace and outside agitators. But the Christians pressed on in the conviction that they were a colony of heaven. Keep that word, because friends, I keep feeling as if almost Heartland is a colony of heaven. God's called us. We are living together here as a multi-ethnic congregation. We're trying to learn from each other. We build the bridge. God is bringing through Heartland Church a model of what it means of racial healing and racial reconciliation. I just want to affirm you of that. Keep it up. It's not easy. But this is the work of God and is a colony of heaven. They were called to obey God rather than man. Small in number, they were big in commitment. They were too God-intoxicated to be astronomically intimidated. Only the words of Martin Luther King can do this with the English language. By their effort and example, they brought an end to such ancient evils as infanticide and gladiatorial contests. Now, they brought an end to a lot of things, but these two he's referenced in this letter. This small colony of heaven. We look at evil in the world, but God has called us to overcome the evil. He's given us the power. Evil will not reign as long as God's people, the colony of heaven, are doing exactly what he said. So let me tell you what infanticide is. Infanticide, during Roman times, it was a common practice to kill babies, to kill children with disabilities, to kill children that people thought, well, and they would even take them to the philosophers and say, well, measure them. Are they strong enough? Not strong enough? Not only just kill them, they would just simply throw them away on the dung heaps. Throw them in the garbage. Throw them on the side of the road. You see, it was mass killings of babies and children that they deemed unfit, handicapped, female babies thrown away. Even the philosophers such as Aristotle taught that unless a child was fit, it needed to go. Now that permeated the culture, friends. Can you grasp that? That permeated the culture. And these Christians came along and said, no, every person is made in the image of God. And they needed to be treated as they are God's children and need to be treated that way. This makes me remember when Jesus said, let the children come to me, for such is the kingdom of heaven. That's the culture that Jesus was saying this in. We kind of get little, isn't that sweet? No. That was radical language to say that children were valuable. Female children were valuable. So when we begin to look at the words of Jesus in that Roman Empire culture that spread throughout the world at that time, his words were very radical. And the early Christians took this to heart, and that's exactly what they did until they finally were able to get the infanticide of children being killed and thrown away and so forth. The law changed. Now that, my friends, is a colony of heaven at work. Small in number, but the power of God. They say that you can go to the catacombs today and you can see hundreds of little bitty tombs in there. And these are of these many, many children that if they did die, they gave them a burial even. The respect that took place. They were able to kill that. And I just want to say, when we look at evil, God's called us. Paul says we overcome evil with good, which is God. Then the second thing is that they were able to get rid of the gladiatorial contest. Now, I don't know about you if you've ever studied who the gladiators were, but the gladiators were slaves. That's who was thrown out. While the Romans stood and praised and watched and whatever, the gladiators were slaves and they watched them kill each other. And these early Christians said, No, this is not what God has called us. We are not to allow that to take place. And they were finally able to get rid of the gladiator contest. Again, this small colony of heaven. Is this not the fast, God said, that I have called you regarding to break the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke? Well, as we move forward and as we look at issues that we're dealing with today, God wants to bring justice. And justice is justice and righteousness. You can't just have justice without righteousness. I know there's big discussion about this word, but it's in the Bible. Biblical justice. In fact, Amos says, let justice roll down like a river and righteousness as a never-failing stream. Justice and righteousness go together. It has to be the people of God that do this, and it's what makes it solid and finished. Today, I was also thinking of Rosa Parks, as we think of Martin Luther King, and we think of some of these great saints. And I think about Rosa Parks when she sat on that bus, and that isn't the only thing she did. If you go back and look at Rosa Parks, she did a lot of things. And that day that she sat on, she was 72 years old when she did that. So I'm saying today, it isn't just for young people to do this or younger people. God's called all of us, and we're his people to fight for the rights of people and justice, his cause for justice in the world until we die. And Rosa Parks, she did, many things, and it was not easy. We look at it and we tell the story and it looks like it's easy. Well, she sat on the bus. What was wrong with that? No. She drug off, etc. She sat on the bus that day and desegregated the bus system in Birmingham or in Montgomery. But Martin Luther King says it this way. He says, when someone asks her about her weariness and how tired she must be, and as he says in his only as Martin Luther King can speak. He says, as she said this in her ungrammatical profundity. These were her words and I love them. She said, my feet is tired, but my soul is at rest. My friends, when we are the colony of heaven, God's people, it isn't always easy. And our feet may be tired, but our soul is at rest. God bless you.
His name is Jesus, my Savior's cross has set the sinner free. It's time for individual prayer. Come grab a prayer card. Take a look at the post-it notes on the walls. Let's go into a time of prayer and come back at 6:45.
The goodness of God.
the goodness of God. We're singing it today. Praise God. We're going to pray today the 23rd Psalm. And I just want to say someone brought up to me and gave me these words, and I want us to pray those right now too. It's out of Malachi. It says, "But to you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. And you shall go out and grow fat." Well, don't know if we want to do that or not. "Like stall-fed calves. You shall trample the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day I do this, says the Lord." Praise God. That's about evil, and God's called us against that. Lord Jesus, this morning we pray. We thank you. You are our shepherd. Most of us here don't even know what shepherds are, and I don't know much about it myself. But Lord, we thank you that when we look at a shepherd, you're taking care of us. You know more than we know about ourselves. So we thank you this morning and we praise you. And you said that we would not want. Now that doesn't make sense, but it's what you know that we need. We thank you that you're giving that to us this morning. You will lead us, it says. You will lead us in green pastures. In other words, you're going to lead us, Jesus. We ask you today, this very day, to lead us. Lead us in our thoughts. Lead us in good thoughts, green pastures of good thoughts. Lead us in ways that build us up for your glory. Lead us today in with people, to people that you want us to be with. Lead us today to people that you want us to encourage. Lord, you know people that are out there that are in a that need you in the most desperate ways. And you're going to lead us to those people today, Lord. But also, Lord, give us eyes to see. Help us to see it. I ask today that we don't be so selfish that we're only thinking about our own problems today. But open our eyes to see people that need you. And as we, Lord, are touching other people, you're healing us. I thank you for that today. And that's what this leading us into green pastures today. And beside still waters, Lord, that thank you for giving us peace in our own soul today. Many of us here, all of us, have parts in our life that we don't know what to do with. We don't know, Lord, how to answer. We don't know what to do next. But those quiet waters, Lord, today, you're going to give us your wisdom. You're going to give us your thoughts. You're going to give us your peace. You're going to give us our soul at rest. Thank you for that today, Lord. I look forward to what you're going to do in this day in my own life, but in every single person that's here. May this day, and it's a holiday and it, for many folks, may it be a glorious day today, Lord, more than just a holiday that we clean the house or we work on the car. But even as we're doing that, may it be a day that brings glory to you. And then, Lord, you said you would guide us in paths of righteousness. Big word, but that means you will guide us in ways in which we will bring peace. We will bring your holiness. It will just ooze from us when we don't even know it. So today, Lord, thank you. And you have said that you would be with us in all things. I think of that scripture that says, "The sun will not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night." In other words, day or night. We're not going to wake up, Lord, in the middle of the night with fear, as Pastor Darren talked about yesterday, that 3 o'clock fear. Lord, I pray that you will guide us when that happens, that we defeat Satan in every way at 3 o'clock in the morning. Satan is defeated, Lord. I've experienced it too. I know. I know what it is. And we're not going to listen to those voices when we are at our weakest point at 3 o'clock in the morning. So, Lord, today we come up against that in the name of Jesus. And we're going to have peaceful nights. We're going to rest. And then you said, even though we're in the valley of the shadow of death, you're with us. That means that maybe friends that we're with who are struggling with sickness and illness, or ourselves in this place today, Lord, struggling with uncertain diagnoses, but you are still with us in that, and you are protecting us, and you can heal us, and I thank you for the healing that takes place in this. And then, Lord, the next thing you said in here was, you will do something about our enemies, that you're going to prepare a table before our enemies. Now, Lord, today, many help us with our enemies. Many of us think we don't have any, but we have people we don't like. So today, Lord, I ask you, Jesus taught us to say, to pray for our enemies. So today, Lord, we pray for the people that we don't like or don't like us. Now, Lord, help us to do that and help us to pray. Pray just to say, Lord, give me wisdom with these people. You love them. Help me to love them. Lord Jesus, the enemies are probably one of the most difficult things we deal with. You said, pray for the enemies. You said, do good for your enemies. So today, Lord Jesus, as we follow you, help us to radically follow you today in this. Instead of talking about our enemies, today, Lord Jesus, can you help us to pray for our enemies? And we look forward to what you're going to do with this. We're following you. We're being obedient to you. And we're doing what you said, and you will bless us. You will bless our enemies. You will bless us. You will give us wisdom in this. I thank you for those prayers. And then, Lord Jesus, you said that you would fill our cup and it would run over. Today, this very day, Lord, praise you that you're going to fill our cup with what we need today. You said you would give us what we need. Now, it isn't what we want, but what we need, Lord Jesus. And I thank you today that you're going to give us our needs. Help us to see it. Help us to accept our needs. I thank you that you want to do this. And Lord, you asked us and told us to pray, to talk with you, to be in communion with you. And then we only know what you can do. And it is beyond what we can ask, think, or imagine. So today, dear Lord, as we go out of this place, as we go about our business today, help us today, Lord, to think your thoughts. Help us to imagine in goodness what you want in us. Help us today to ask. And you said, if we ask, it shall be done. And you said, if we rejoice in you. And today, may we go out of here rejoicing in you today. Rejoice, rejoice in the Lord. And our joy comes as we rejoice in you today. So today, Lord, we just at this moment lift our hands. Everyone lift your hand to the Lord and shout out to the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your love. And Lord, today we lift that and we go in this day with this on our mind and in our heart, rejoicing in you. The joy of the Lord is our strength, you told us, and we are going to live in that joy today. Amen.
Amen. Come on, give God praise today. We love you, Lord. We praise your name. I am so grateful for you.
Thank you.
Come on, give God praise for Dr. Joanne Lyon. I'm so glad she's here, and what a great word. Listen, the 23rd Psalm, I love that you chose that. It is the Lord's Prayer of the Old Testament, and I send you out today with those last words. Think about this. What can the enemy do to you? What can the spirit of fear do to you when you're convinced that surely goodness and mercy will follow me today and all the days of my life? That means what God's planned good things no matter what. So even the things that look bad, he'll turn around and work for good. And mercy means every time I make a mistake, I can just run right back to his love. Build your love on that today. You are the beloved of God. In you, he is well pleased. I'm so proud of you for being here this morning. We'll be back here tomorrow morning for day 10. We're almost at the halfway point, everybody. And it's getting better every day. So go have the best Monday. Go enjoy yourself. And I'll see you back tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. God bless you.